those who may be forgetting the lessons of October 7th and talking about Hamas as the aggressor in that attack.
Doesn't seem as though there's
Miss U.S.
a bit of a romantic gardener.
It states as
come up
or served a boy.
So we really wanted to understand
practicing self-care.
It's your news playlist.
Still within the production system and must also create.
This is an NBC News special report.
Oh,
here's
no.
Lester Holt.
Good morning. We're coming on the air with breaking news. And
so the moment when Israel is committing a massive war crime against your wishes, you're going to go out there and just start covering for it by speaking about a Holocaust that happened in the 40s instead of the Holocaust that's happening right now. It's fucking depraved.
Washington, where President Biden is about to give a major speech about anti-Semitism at the U.S. Capitol. The event, part of the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum's remembrance ceremony today. The event marks a rare address from the president about anti-Semitism, a form of hatred that's emerged as a flashpoint in American politics in the wake of the Israel-Hamas war, which sparked a ripple effect
it's of anti-Jewish violence. Wait a minute.
And
listen to this framing,
here at
man.
Home. The speech also comes as a critical
moment. Who are the major anti-Semites? Who's the big anti-Semite? Who's the anti-Semite leaders? Who's the big anti-Semitic groups? What are they saying that's anti-Semitic, and why is it anti-Semitic? Notice how none of these fucking rats can ever tell the truth. They can never give an example of what they're talking about. They have to just do this kind of like, they use the word and implication, but they never point the finger at anyone, because as soon as they do, they have to actually contend with what's being said. This is all bad faith bullshit.
For that conflict and against the backdrop of college protests around the country calling for an end to the war. President, I believe, now entering the room there. We will hear from him momentarily. He's going to go, looks like he's going to go straight to the podium. And we'll listen in.
I hate this piece of shit so much.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you, and please. Thank you, Stu Eisenstadt, for that introduction, for your leadership in the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. You're a true scholar and statesman, and a dear friend. Speaker Johnson, Leader Jeffries, members of Congress, and especially the survivors of the Holocaust. My mother will hear she look at you and say, God love you all. God love you all. Abe Foxman and all other survivors who embody absolute courage and dignity and grace are here as well. During these sacred days of remembrance, we grieve, we give voice to the 6 million Jews who were systematically targeted and murdered by the Nazis and their collaborators during World War II. We honor the memory of victims, the pain of survivors, the bravery of heroes who stood up to Hitler's unspeakable evil, and we recommit to heeding and heeding the lessons that one of the darkest chapters in human history, to revitalize and realize the responsibility of never again. Never again, simply translated for me, means never forget. Never forget. Never forgetting means we must keep telling the story. We must keep teaching the truth. We must keep teaching our children and our grandchildren. And the truth is, we're at risk of people not knowing the truth. That's why, growing up, my dad taught me and my siblings about the horrors of the Shoah at our family dinner table. That's why
you didn't have a history fucking book. Your dad was a car salesman. This is just a lie he's making up. Did Biden's dad even serve in World War II? Biden Sr. later became a successful used car salesman. So I don't say anything about his father serving in World War II. So where does father learn anything? Like, what does his dad know? He read news stories? Like, what does this even mean? This is dumb as fuck. Thank you, energy.
Yad Vashem with my family as a senator, as vice president, as president. And that's why I took my grandchildren to Dachau so they could see and bear witness to the perils of indifference, the complicity of silence in the face of evil that they knew was happening. Germany, 1933, Hitler and his Nazi party rise to power by rekindling one of the world's oldest forms of prejudice and hate. Anti-Semitism. His rule didn't begin with mass murder. It started slowly across economic, political, social, and cultural life. Propaganda demonizing Jews, boycotts of Jewish businesses, synagogues defaced with swastikas, harassment of Jews in the street and in the schools, anti-Semitic demonstrations, pogroms, organized riots. With the indifference of the world, Hitler knew he could expand his reign of terror by eliminating Jews from Germany to annihilate Jews across Europe through genocide, the Nazis called the final solution. Concentration camps, gas chambers, mass shootings. By the time the war ended, 6 million Jews, one out of every three Jews in the entire world, were murdered. This ancient hatred of Jews didn't begin with the Holocaust. It didn't end with the Holocaust either, or after, even after our victory in World War II. This hatred continues to lie deep in the hearts of too many people in the world and requires our continued vigilance and outspokenness. That hatred was brought to life on October 7th in 2023. On a sacred Jewish holiday, the terrorist group Hamas unleashed the deadliest day of the Jewish people since the Holocaust.
Which is, okay. I'm glad he said deadliest day, because that was very smart, right? That was very smart to say deadliest day, because it isn't the most Jews that have been killed by a government or an entity since the Holocaust. It was Argentina's dirty war. According to human rights organizations in Argentina, between 1900 and 3000 Jews were among the 30,000 who were targeted by the Argentine military junta. It's a disproportionate number, as Jews comprise between 5 to 12% of those targeted, but only 1% of the population. The Dirty War was a 7-year campaign by the Argentine government to eliminate suspected dissidents and subversives. The campaign included arrests, tortures, assassinations, mass shootings, rape, cremation, and dumping bodies into rivers and oceans. The official figure for disappearances is 10, but human rights groups claim the death toll could be as high as 30,000. Now, who supported that Argentine junta? How did they get into power, guys? The national reorganization process, often simply called the process, was the military dictatorship that ruled Argentina from 1976 to 1983, which received support from the United States until 1982. The Argentine Armed Forces seized political power during March 1976 coup. Political parties were banned, democracy suspended, civil rights limited, free market and deregulation policies were introduced. A campaign of state terrorism against opponents involving torture, extrajudicial murder, and systemic forced disappearances, with most victims being civilians. But hey, guys, when the U.S. killed 3,000 Jews supporting a right-wing dictatorship that destroys democracy, that doesn't even deserve a mention. But Hamas kills 800 civilians. Well, I mean, the Hamas, did they even kill that many? We don't know because Israel wouldn't investigate the deaths. A population under siege, a population under blockade with no rights, no state, stateless, not allowed to have cookies, not allowed to have water pipes. Biden was in the Senate at that time. Yep. Now, October 7th is such a huge crime, though. Remember that. Did anyone get prosecuted for the Argentine military junta? What do you think?
Driven by ancient desire to wipe out the Jewish people off the face of the earth, over 1,200 innocent people, babies, parents, grandparents, slaughtered in their kibbutz, massacred at a music festival, brutally raped, mutilated, and sexually assaulted. Thousands more carrying wounds, bullets and shrapnel from the memory of that terrible day they endured. Hundreds taken hostage, including survivors of the Shoah. Now, here we are, not 75 years later, but just 7.5 months later, and people are already forgetting. They're already forgetting that Hamas unleashed this terror. It was Hamas that brutalized Israelis. It was Hamas who took and continues to hold hostages. I have not forgotten, nor have you, and we will not forget.
Say that again. I gotta back this up.
Parents, grandparents, our harassment of Jews in the street and the school during World War II.
Okay, I'm sorry, Chad. I have to start from the beginning because I don't think I heard it right. I don't think I heard it right. Because if I heard it right, if I heard what he's saying right, then all of us should seriously arm up and exercise our Second Amendment rights to defend our property and our homes and our families. And set up a mutual self-defense network. I don't know if I heard this right.
The memory of victims, the pain of survivors, the bravery of heroes who stood up to Hitler's unspeakable evil, and we recommit to heeding and heeding the lessons that one of the darkest chapters in human history, to revitalize and realize the responsibility of never again. Never again, simply translated for me, means never forget. Never forget.
That's not what it means. It means never again, you fucking illiterate moron. It doesn't mean never forget. It means never allow another genocide to take place, you fucking rat. Like, what are you talking about?
Forgetting means we must keep telling the story. We must keep teaching the truth. We must keep teaching our children and our grandchildren. And the truth is, we're at risk of people not knowing the truth. That's why, growing up, my dad taught me and my siblings about the horrors of the Shoah at our family dinner table. That's why I visited Yad Vashem with my family as a senator, as vice president, and as president. And that's why I took my grandchildren to Dachau so they could see and bear witness to the perils of indifference, the complicity of silence in the face of evil that they knew was happening.
The irony.
Germany, 1933.
United States of America, 2024.
Hitler and his Nazi party rise to power by rekindling one of the world's oldest forms of prejudice and hate, anti-Semitism.
That is not how they rose to power. They rose to power by targeting the left. There was never an anti-Semitic majority in Germany. This is ahistorical nonsense. They rose to power because of the Reichstag fire, the fake terrorist attack. They blamed it on communists, and liberals and conservatives went along with the Nazis to suppress the left. And that didn't just include communists, but that also included trade unionists, socialists, social democrats. It was absolutely not just anti-Semitism. Now, anti-Semitism was an important part of their racial theory of Aryan supremacy and Jewishness and Jews being an outside racial influence. But it was not why they rose to power. This is just not true. It was liberalism buckling in the face of fascism and deciding to collaborate to maintain capitalism against the threat of a reorganization or revolution, whether it be by reform or bloody civil war. This is just nonsense.
His rule didn't begin with mass murder. It started slowly.
His rule began with immediately arresting and targeting the left and suppressing the left with violence. That was immediately what he did, including when before Hitler achieved absolute power, he passed this bill. I've talked about it a number of times on here, but I think this history is important. It was called the Enabling Act. That basically gave him executive and legislative power and kind of put Germany in a state of emergency. Before they did that, they arrested social democrats and communists who were elected members of parliament. The Social Democrats being the second largest party in Germany. But they represented the so-called reformist socialism. There was the KPT, was the Communist Party of Germany. They were all arrested. So when the vote came to give Hitler absolute power in parliament, about half of the SPD, that's the socialists, the Social Democrats, were there. They voted against it. All the communist reps, which was like 70 or so of them, they were all in prison already or fled. So the people that who voted for absolute power for Nazi Germany were the center party. You hear that right. The centrist, liberal, moderate Catholic party, the center party. The conservative move, the Christian Democrats aligned with Hitler. The industrialists. That's who gave Hitler power. It was not a wave of anti-Semitism. A virulent anti-Semitism was always a minority position in Germany. It never became a majority position, but yet it became policy. The Holocaust happened because liberals were cowardly. And also, and this is to the eternal shame of both the communists and the socialists, is that they didn't form a popular front until way too late. They were bickering amongst themselves way too late. And they finally decided to enter into a united front, and they were bickering over who should be in charge. And then when the moment came to call their people out on the streets and to launch a civil war, they hesitated. A civil war in Germany was the right call, and nobody made that call. They thought the institutions would protect them. That's what you need to remember right now.
Across economic, political, social, and cultural life. Propaganda demonizing Jews. Boycotts of Jewish businesses. Synagogues defaced with swastikas. Harassment of Jews in the street and in the schools. Anti-Semitic demonstrations, pogroms, organized riots. With the indifference of the world, Hitler knew he could expand his reign of terror by eliminating Jews from Germany, to annihilate Jews across Europe through genocide, the Nazis called the final solution. Concentration camps.
Massive concentration camp called Gaza.
Gas chambers. Mass shootings. By the time the war ended, 6 million Jews, one out of every three Jews in the entire world, were murdered. This ancient hatred of Jews didn't begin with the Holocaust. It didn't end with the Holocaust either, or after, even after our victory in World War II. This hatred continues to lie deep in the hearts of too many people in the world and requires our continued vigilance and outspokenness. Propaganda demonizing Jews, boycotts of Jewish businesses, synagogues defaced with swastikas, harassment of Jews in the street and in the schools, anti-Semitic.
That happened after the fascists got power, you liberal twat. After the left was targeted by liberals, you liberal twat.
Demonstrations. Pogroms, organized riots. With the indifference of the world, Hitler knew he could expand his reign of terror by eliminating Jews from Germany, to annihilate Jews across Europe through genocide, the Nazis called the final solution. Concentration camps, gas chambers, mass shootings. By the time the war ended, 6 million Jews, one out of every three Jews in the entire world, were murdered. This ancient hatred of Jews didn't begin with the Holocaust. It didn't end with the Holocaust either, or after, even after our victory in World War II. This hatred continues to lie deep in the hearts of too many people in the world and requires our continued vigilance and outspokenness. That hatred was brought to life on October 7th in 2023. On a sacred Jewish holiday, the terrorist group Hamas unleashed the deadliest day of the Jewish people since the Holocaust. Driven by ancient desire to wipe out the Jewish people off the face of the earth, over 1,200 innocent people, babies, parents.
One baby. Was killed with it when a bullet accidentally went through a door. One. So when he said babies, that's just a lie.
Grandparents slaughtered in their kibbutz, massacred in a
We don't know who killed who because there's no investigations that were allowed.
Festival.
Also, not, I mean, do you think an IDF soldier enforcing a blockade and operating an unmanned machine gun emplacement is an innocent person? I mean, are we straining the definition of the word innocent at that point?
Brutally raped, mutilated, and sexually assaulted. Thousands more carrying wounds, bullets and shrapnel from the memory of that terrible day they endured. Hundreds taken hostage, including survivors of the Shoah. Now, here we are, not 75 years later, but just 7.5 months later. And people are already forgetting. They're already forgetting that Hamas unleashed this terror. It was Hamas that brutalized Israelis.
Now, Israel has been brutalizing Israelis every day. Hundreds were murdered in the West Bank prior to October 7th. 40,000 people have been murdered. 100,000 have been seriously wounded, grievously wounded. I mean, I don't even understand. Like, this doesn't even make sense. Like, this doesn't... This legitimately... He can't be... I mean, you can't vote for this guy. Like, obviously, we're voting against this guy. It's nonsense. Like, there's really nothing much to say here. And we've got to make the DNC an utter catastrophe for the Democrats. So that's what I'm going to be doing for the rest of this year. We're going to Chicago. We're going to Chicago. Get in shape.
It was Hamas who took and continues to hold hostages.
Israel has taken literally thousands of Palestinians in with no criminal charge and held them in detention. What would you call that but a hostage? If any of these crimes are bad, which they are, Israel is guilty of them a 20-fold.
I have not forgotten, nor have you. And we will not forget. And as Jews around the world still cope with the atrocities and trauma of that day and its aftermath, we've seen a ferocious surge of anti-Semitism in America and around the world. Vicious propaganda on social media. Jews forced to keep their hide, their keepers under baseball hats, tuck their Jewish stars into their shirts. On college campuses, Jewish students blocked, harassed, attacked while walking to class. Anti-Semitism.
What?
We've seen a ferocious surge of anti-Semitism in America and around the world. Vicious propaganda on social media. Jews.
What?
Forced to keep their hide, their keepers under baseball hats, tuck their Jewish stars into their shirts.
Where? When?
On college campuses.
When?
Jewish students blocked, harassed, attacked while walking to class.
When? What sources, what news story are you talking about? And by the way, if a single anti-Semite does something, there are anti-Semites, there are fascists that do exist. That is not anything to do with the campus protests, which is why he's citing campuses right now.
Anti-Semitism, anti-Semitic posters, slogans, calling for the annihilation of Israel. The world's only Jewish state.
He's got to be defeated. He's got to be defeated. There's really no compromising with this. Get him out. The Democratic Party has to be riven with internal fighting, and it has to be ripped apart. This motherfucker wants to get you. This is a personal threat to you. You should be aware. I agree with Felix. Trump won in 2016 because he was the most moderate candidate. Joe's rhetoric proves it. Trump will have a harder time winning now, but this is hard facts. I don't think that Trump won in 2016 because he was moderate. I think Trump won in 2016 because he represented change and he was a spit in the eye of people like Joe Biden, and everybody hates these fucking rats. And they knew that Donald Trump winning would make them mad. That's all they wanted, was to make these scum mad.
Too many people denying, downplaying, rationalizing, ignoring the horrors of the Holocaust.
That is not happening.
October 7th, including Hamas's appalling use of sexual violence to torture and terrorize Jews. It's absolutely despicable, and it must stop. Silence. Silence and denial can hide much, but it can erase nothing. Some injustices are so heinous, so horrific, so grievous, they cannot be buried, no matter how hard people try.
Chat, if you want to go to Chicago, reply to this post.
In my view, a major lesson of the Holocaust is, as mentioned earlier, was not inevitable. We know hate never goes away, it only hides. And given a little oxygen, it comes out from under the rocks. We also know what stops hate. One thing, all of us. The late Rabbi...
What's in Chicago? The Democratic National Convention. Soundbite is up under colonizer? Okay, hold on. What a fucking disgusting piece of shit.
The colonizer lied. The colonizer lied. The colonizer lied. The colonizer lied. The colonizer lied.
Whatever Biden talks.
The colonizer lied.
Jonathan Sachs described anti-Semitism as a virus that has survived and mutated over time. Together, we cannot continue to let that happen. We have to remember our basic principles as a nation. We have an obligation. We have an obligation to learn the lessons of history so we don't surrender our future to the horrors of the past. We must give hate no safe harbor against anyone. Anyone. From the very founding, our very founding, Jewish Americans, who represent only about 2% of the U.S. population, have helped lead the cause of freedom for everyone in our nation. From that experience, we know scapegoating and demonizing any minority is a threat to every minority. And the very foundation...
God smiles upon us. It says that post has been deleted. Do you have a screenshot? Macro Lino, thank you for the 40 months. Chicago tried to restrict DNC protest. Democratic National Convention security plan could affect Chicago residents near United Center. Oh, we'll take a look at this.
Of our democracy. So in moments like this, we have to put these principles that we're talking about into action. I understand people have strong beliefs and deep convictions about the world. In America, we respect and protect the fundamental right to free speech, to debate and disagree, to protest peacefully, and make our voices heard. I understand. That's America. But there is no place on any campus in America, any place in America, for anti-Semitism or hate speech or threats of violence of any kind. whether against Jews or anyone else. Violent attacks, destroying property, is not peaceful.
I mean, the entire Gaza Strip has been leveled. I mean, 70% of residences, according to a study from months ago, were damaged or destroyed. Leaving hospital, just got some extremely bad health news that will impact every area of my career.
Then die.
What do we do, argue with you? I'm not on the debate team.
Peaceful protest. It's against the law. And we are not a lawless country. We're a civil society. We uphold the rule of law. And no one should have to hide or be brave just to be themselves.
Is this because yesterday people were responding to her saying she endangered her career as a Zionist and everybody was like, what career? Yeah, there's, I mean, like, what career? You know, like, reply guying Destiny on Twitter is not a career. Humiliating the Young Turks and dividing them from their strongest asset. Can you imagine if the Young Turks had a modicum of intelligence? They would have been begging Hassan on their hands and knees to do a show for them. If they had a modicum of intelligence, they would have begged him on... Cenk should have been crawling to his nephew's house, which is bigger than his, and been like, please... Please come on once a week. Please. But instead they like, what are they chasing around Destiny and these like and Vouch? That was what they did. They chased around Destiny and Vouch until Vouch got revealed as a pedophile, right? Pathetic. Because they're jealous. Just pathetic. They actually got rid of him. He used to have a show on there. And they got rid of the show. Right before he like quadrupled in size. And he was already bigger than them at that point. What a fucking dumbass. What a complete fucking dumbass. I mean, what do you expect from the place that created Dave Rubin and Jimmy Dore and has that virulent Zionist on there now? They hired a guy because he made Charlie Kirk look stupid, who just happens to be a virulent Zionist. So now they have a Zionist freak warmonger propagandist on their show. I mean, it's just a joke, man. What a pathetic book group.
To the Jewish community, I want you to know, I see your fear, your hurt, and your pain. Let me reassure you, as your president, you're not alone. You belong. You always have and you always will. And my commitment to the safety of the Jewish people, the security of Israel, and its right to exist as an independent Jewish state is ironclad, even when we disagree. My administration is working around the clock to free remaining hostages.
Then why are you allowing Israel to not accept the... why are you giving Israel the bombs to do their genocide as opposed to pressuring them to accept the ceasefire that was proposed by Egypt, a country that we give billions of dollars to every year for their military? But you don't trust Egypt? You don't trust the dictator that we put in with a CIA coup? You don't trust Qatar, which gives us military bases, like, and is a major American ally? Like, what? Are those American allies our enemies? Or is Israel fucking genocidal freaks? Honestly, I can say this, and I can say this, that the nations, the Arab nations, have covered themselves, like the allies of the United States are just covered themselves in shame that will live through the ages. Can you imagine being a citizen of Saudi Arabia or Syria or Jordan, or like the shame. I mean, I know why Israel will use nuclear weapons and it's a pariah state. And I know why they can't, but the shame. The shame. Disgusting. Only Yemen, only scrappy little Yemen, which had a famine itself, was able to organize any resistance at all. Balbazar, thank you for the prime. Any comrade want to gift a sub? I subbed to Greblo because of Gold Kappa, LOL. He got a Gold Kappa hype train! Greblo got a Gold Kappa hype train? You gotta be fucking kidding me.
Just as we have freed hostages already, and we'll not rest until we bring them all home. My administration, with our second gentleman's leadership, has launched our nation's first national strategy to counter anti-Semitism that's mobilizing the full force of the federal government to protect Jewish communities.
So in other words, he's going to be using political spies and political... Joe Biden is calling for... Make no mistake. Joe Biden is calling for political police to investigate anyone who opposes the genocide. This is Joe Biden's Gestapo. This is Joe Biden's Stasi. This is Joe Biden's... I don't know what to say. This is Joe Biden's Gestapo. Like, this is the Joe Biden's SS. This is Joe Biden's FBI con intel pro. This is Joe Biden's Red Scare. This is Joe Biden's fascism.
But we know it's not the work of government alone. Or Jews alone. That's why I'm calling on all Americans to stand united against anti-Semitism and hate in all its forms.
I just want to say this, just so this is very clear for anybody who might be coming in here. We are virulently against anti-Semitism here. But we do not conflate what the state of Israel is doing with Jewish people. We do not conflate Jewish brothers and sisters and citizens of this country with Zionists. Freaks believe in Jewish supremacy and want to commit a genocide and ethnic cleansing of Palestine. We love our Jewish comrades and friends, and we respect their ancient religion, which has been on the right side of history. And so many Jewish comrades have fought for the liberation of humanity. I just want to be very clear on that. This is fucking gross that he's conflating fighting anti-Semitism with fighting for Zionism. He has got to be defeated by any means necessary.
A friend who became a friend, the late Elie Wiesel, said, quote, "One person of integrity can make a difference." We have to remember that now more than ever. Here in Emancipation Hall, the U.S. Capitol, among the towering statue to history is a bronze bust of Roald Wallenberg. Born in Sweden as a Lutheran, he was a businessman and a diplomat. While stationed in Hungary during World War II, he used diplomatic cover to hide and rescue about 100,000 Jews over a six-month period. Among them was a 16-year-old Jewish boy who escaped a Nazi labor camp. After the war ended, that boy received a scholarship from the Hillel Foundation to study in America. He came to New York City penniless, but determined to turn his pain into purpose, along with his wife, also a Holocaust survivor. He became a renowned economist and foreign policy thinker, eventually making his way to this very Capitol on the staff of a first-term senator. That Jewish refugee was Tom Lantos, and that senator was me. Tom and his wife Annette and their family became dear friends to me and my family.
Who will you vote for then? Here's a speech I want to show you about voting.
So what you and I have got to do is get involved. You and I have to be right there breathing down their throat. Every time they look over their shoulder, we want them to see us. We want to make them pass the strongest civil rights bill they've ever passed. Because we know even after they pass it, they can't enforce it. In order to do this, we're starting a voters registration drive. We have to get everybody in Harlem registered. Not as Democrats or Republicans, but registered as independents. If you don't have the sense of responsibility to get registered, we'll move you out of town.
Malcolm called for an aggressive plan, not only to gain political power, but to move black people towards total control of their community.
It's going to be the ballot or the bullet.
Other ethnic and racial groups come in.
Oh no, we have a narrator lady? Oh fuck, we had narrators?
Mr. Moderator?
This is... I didn't want the full speech.
Why does it look like it might be the year of the ballot or the bullet? Because Negroes have listened to the trickery and the lies and the false promises of the white man now for too long. And they're fed up. They've become disenchanted. They've become disillusioned. They've become dissatisfied. And all.
How do you keep your head level with constant bombardment of stressful news? What I would say is that the people of Gaza require me to have a level head. The children of Gaza who are being annihilated with my tax dollars require me to have a level head. The people around the world that are fighting for freedom and liberation, the struggles that I see. You know, I went to LA this weekend for my 40th birthday, chat, to visit some friends, and VO threw me a surprise party. And I was incredibly gratified to have so many amazing friends and colleagues come together and have a good time. But as I was driving around town and I saw the decrepitude of LA, I was just incensed. It was really fucking pathetic. People camped on the sidewalk. Roads that look like they haven't been resurfaced in 45 years. No public transit. Trash. Weeds. Rotten. I mean, how many rotten, shitty strip malls built in the 50s can you have? It's like this area hasn't had an ounce of public investment in generations. This is what voting for Democrats gets you? It's a fucking shithole! And this is one of the most desirable places in the world, where getting a small little bungalow will run you over $1 million! For a two-bedroom bungalow! I was disgusted because Southern California is by far and away the most attractive climb in the world for human beings. The pleasant sea breeze, the perfect humidity. Sunny days. lush and fertile fields, clear, cool ocean water, powdery sandy beaches, just gorgeous snow-capped mountains. One of the most beautiful places on earth, and it's a fucking ruin. The unbelievable concentrated wealth, and nothing works. It's fucking unbelievable. And I was just sitting there as I was driving around and I was just shaking my head and I was like, this is fucking disgusting. And Americans don't even see it. They don't even see it. We're spending $100 trillion, billion, quadrillion dollars on wars abroad. And the streets are the most hostile shit to humanity I've ever seen. And everybody wants you to talk about some petty ass bullshit. You better vote for the Democrats or you're not going to have the right to control your own body. Oh, well, that's already true in half the country. Well, if you don't vote for Joe Biden, then we're going to take it away from even more places. What is this pathetic loser Democratic Party? The just most corrupt, worthless sack of shit party. They had a $70 billion surplus in California. Where did it go? Where the fuck did it go? It didn't go to making the streets clean. It didn't go to making sure that people could move around in a renewable and sustainable and efficient way. It didn't go to housing the homeless. It didn't go to cleaning up the environment. Oh, the air quality. Oh, I didn't even mention that. The dog shit air quality. Oh, poisoned air. Fucking pathetic. And I was just incensed. I know that maybe I guess I'm arrogant for even looking at the world like the way that I do. I don't know what to say. Like looking at and going, doesn't this make you ashamed? Aren't you ashamed as an American to go out into your communities and see the disrepair? Aren't you ashamed to see your neighbor suffering? Aren't you fucking disgusted? That we, and here's what makes me ashamed, is we have the wealth and the productivity so that not one person is homeless and not one person goes hungry and not one person dies of medical problems. We already have the wealth. We have the knowledge. Where's the will? Where's the shame? Why do you let yourself get tricked to vote for men like Joe Biden? We voted for this fucker, and I'm one of these people, to my eternal shame, who was like, well, you know, you gotta make the lesser of two evils, and if the Democrats get everything, maybe they can pass some laws. But here's the reality. The Democratic Party, as it stands today, is utterly corrupted, and it will never change. What are they doing to try to the 90 Democrats that are any good in Congress? What are they doing? They're trying to spend billions of dollars to unseat them. They're trying to give you more corrupt people. Pathetic.
enfrentando problemas legales? Consumer Law Group, los guardianes del pueblo, es el nombre que usted conoce y ha confiado por más de 12 años. Inmigración, ley familiar.
Cool. We got ourselves a law firm doing a Spanish-speaking ad. I live here in Los Angeles. This place is a shithole. Much of the state is pure trash. State human capital statistics are abysmal. So what do we do? Don't expect answers here.
Riders are raising concerns about old bridges, noting that one particular bridge appears to be in disrepair. NBC5's Chris Coffey has the story and a response from Metra.
Trump will be worse. I want you to understand something. What's worse, a bullet to the back of the head or the bullet to the front of the face? You're dead either way. You need to change the paradigm. My today's Indiana GOP primary. I've heard there is a swell of Democrats voting in an effort to stop Mike Braun from getting elected by voting for another GOP candidate, even if none of them are wanted. Is it a sound strategy in your opinion if we truly want to stop Braun? I mean, go ahead. You're moving deck chairs around on the Titanic. Thank you for the 1,000 bits. And I, you know what? You want to vote for a slightly less bad person? Congratulations. You've done nothing. Until we have a politics where people are actually constructive instead of defensive, we're fucked.
Metra trains pass over West Peterson Avenue every day along with thousands of riders, but online, people are talking about these bridge support beams that you can see right through.
It's not just me that finds this type of visual corrosion horrifying. It's something that I feel like if anyone stopped and really took a look at, they would be somewhat concerned about.
Brendan Kaplan says he rides the UP North Line several days a week and says these visuals of corroded beams do not help the city's image.
It contributes to an aesthetic that our infrastructure is crumbling, and that's the type of aesthetic that the city's been trying to reject for a while now.
Many of Chicago's railroad bridges are 120 years old, and transportation expert Joe Schwederman says
120 years old. Do you not feel the shame? Do you not feel the shame? Six generations old. Six generations.
The weather has taken its toll on them.
You know, in the early 20th century, there was the big push to get railroad lines above grade. So we had embankments and bridges, and so many of those bridges, you know, relieve congestion, but now they need to be replaced. And we just haven't been able to keep up.
In fact, Metra says the bridges can no longer be economically repaired and maintained. So they've announced a rebuild of the UP North Line, which will replace 11 bridges between Fullerton Avenue and Cornelia Avenue. And Metra is also addressing the bridge over West Peterson.
According to Metra, a new train station is being built nearby. And as part of that project, this bridge will be renovated.
Metra says repairs to the bridges over West Peterson and nearby Ridge Avenue are scheduled to be done by the end of the summer.
We have infrastructure funding that's going to help get these fixed, but we're behind the eight ball on this.
In the Edgewater neighborhood, Chris Coffey, NBC 5 News.
Lots of action.
I'm sorry. I got off on this rant because I was watching Joe Biden. Let's finish Joe Biden. Meanwhile, by the way, chat, we are well over 3 hours into the stream. And here, you know, I'm going to do my pitch. All right. If you enjoy this type of content, if you want to be part of a constructive movement that's not just fiddling around at the edges, is not just moving the deck chairs around on the Titanic, which is actually saying, hey, iceberg ahead, then please consider supporting this stream and supporting institutions and movements like DSA and PSL and the campus protests. And I'm still formulating what I think we need to do the next step. People are asking me what to do, and I have an answer, but I don't want to be just someone giving off the hip answers without being constructive to help build the thing myself at this point. Nobody's going to rescue us. I think your Chinese understand that Chinese people hate the government. I don't understand why in some ways, but it's consensus with coworkers, dates, friends, to be honest. I mean, I'm sure that that is definitely true among Chinese people, like any other. They mean, but according to what I understand, James, and you're maybe you can give me more insight. A lot of the hate toward the government is the local government. The local governments are very unpopular in China. Burly Bob, thank you for the tier one. Supreme A-hole. By the way, I mean, you know, the people that want to speak English are definitely going to be more bourgeois and more Western aligned. You know what I mean? It's like when you, it's like, my people yearn for freedom. I'm from Venezuela, like, and they're posting on English Twitter. There's a certain type of selection that's happening. Supreme A-hole, thank you for the... Anyway, if you enjoy the content, please consider supporting this stream by subscribing at Tier 1, Tier 2, or Tier 3 sub. Why isn't the left winning? Ooh.
Hello and welcome to Factually. I'm Adam Conover. Thank you so...
Oh. With Boshkar. Burly Bob. Lolo McLefty, thank you both for supporting this review. If you enjoy the content, but I think on PSL, they're all right. Anyway, if you enjoy this content, it'll only survive Utahi talking about poison air, let me introduce you to Beijing. I mean, listen, I think we're very honest about that, but the air quality has massively increased in Beijing, even though it has similar issues that LA does with geography constraining. Like one of the issues with California is there's a west to east wind, and then there's high. High mountains, so it creates a bowl effect, which like traps the polluted air. Anyway, if you enjoy the content, please consider supporting it because it's the only way. It is the only way this channel will survive. James, you should we should have a chat, you and me. Is there best practices on joining local organization groups without getting put on lists? I'd find it hard to believe my local communist group isn't infiltrated by feds. Oh, you could join DSA, but you should just be aware of. Nice, James. We'll have to learn more. You'll have to talk to me more. Wattmob, thank you for the 200 bits. People really don't know about the quite large range of mountains in SoCal. We get snow. We just got to drive up a mountain. Very true. If you're not on a list, you ain't doing shit. There's an old song. There's an old protest song. It's called You Ain't Done Nothing If You Ain't Been Called a Red. This is an oldie. TJ.
When I was just a little thing, I used to love parades with banners, bands, red balloons, and maybe lemonade. When I came home one May Day, my neighbor's father said, "Them marchers is all commies. Tell me, kid, are you a red?"
Anonymous user, thank you for getting us up to James.
What he meant. My hair back then was brown. Our house was plain red brick like most others in the town. So I went and asked my mama why our neighbor called me red. My mommy took me on her knee and this is what she said. Well, you ain't done nothing if you ain't been called a red. If you march or agitated, then you found it yourself. So you might as well ignore it or love the word instead. Cause you ain't been doing nothing if you ain't been called a red.
That's a classic. You ain't done nothing. We live in America. We know the government doesn't do shit. I mean, I think one of the things that is a hard reality for people to swallow is that there isn't going to be some sort of like cavalry that comes. I always tell the people that I meet, they don't understand what it's like to live in a government where nothing happens and people's lives don't get better, but many of them don't accept that. Well, of course. Level 8 on the hype train, by the way, chat. If you enjoy the content, please consider subscribing at Tier 1, Tier 2, or Tier 3. We're doing our best to help create the conditions for revolutionary change. It's why I will never give up on the States. Because I understand that if we actually got a decent government and a decent state in this country and in North America in general, we would be living in an unbelievably wealthy society. We have the education, the knowledge, the resources, the geography, the natural bounty to make this world habitable for all of us. So please consider supporting the stream. It's the only way it's going to exist is with your all, so with all of you supporting it. All right, let's finish Biden.
Tom would go on to become the only Holocaust survivor ever elected to Congress, where he became a leading voice on civil rights and human rights around the world. Tom never met Raul.
Thanks for the level 3 hype.
Was taken prisoner by the Soviets, never to be heard from again. But through Tom's efforts, Raul's bust is here in the Capitol. He was also given honorary U.S. citizenship, only the second person ever after Winston Churchill. The Holocaust Museum here in Washington is located on a road in Raul's name. The story of the power of a single person to put aside our differences, to see our common humanity, to stand up to hate, and its ancient story of resilience from immense pain, persecution, to find hope, purpose, and meaning in life, we try to live and share with one another. That story endures. Let me close with this. I know these days of remembrance fall on difficult times. We all do well to remember. These days also fall during the month we celebrate Jewish American heritage. A heritage that stretches from our earliest days to enrich every single part of American life today. Great American, great Jewish American, named Tom Lantos used the phrase, "The veneer of civilization is paper thin." We are its guardians. And we can never rest. My fellow Americans, we must be those guardians. We must never rest. We must rise against hate, meet across the divide, see our common humanity, and God bless the victims and survivors of the Shoah. May the resilient hearts, the courageous spirit, and the eternal flame of faith of the Jewish people forever shine their light on America and around the world. Pray God. Thank you all.
We got to get rid of this guy.
President Biden delivering a major speech on anti-Semitism.
No place for anti-Semitism on college campuses.
That those who were forgetting the lessons,
man,
of the Holocaust,
like the idea that there's this wave of
anti-Semitism
is just fraudulent on its face.
Of October 7th, and
it's just fraudulent
about Hamas
on its face.
As the aggressor in that attack. Also, the president talking about what we've seen on college campuses, the free speech, but also those who would utter threatening or harassing language toward Jewish students in some of those instances. We want to go straight to our senior White House correspondent, Gabe Gutierrez. Gabe, how long has this speech been coming?
Hi there, Lester. Well, what stuck out to me is what you mentioned, that the president really trying to draw the parallels here between the atrocities of the Holocaust and the horrors that unfolded on October 7th. And as you said, he reiterated that people are already forgetting what happened on October 7th, essentially a message appearing to rebuke the protesters that have become violent across college campuses across this country. So far, there have been more than 2,500 arrests across the country impacting...
Okay, 2,500 arrests. Could you show me some of these anti-Semitic incidents that led to those arrests?
Some 70 campuses nationwide. And the White House has been reiterating this message now for several days, trying to really stress that, yes, peaceful protests are encouraged and accepted, but what should not happen is protesters that cause chaos and break the law. And the president was really trying to walk that fine line, and he reiterated that message.
Walk the fine line. Sorry, chat. I am lining up a very big, very big interview for next Monday. Trying to make sure that that happens.
And rules specifically for the area around DNC activities. CBS2's Lauren Victory explains the impact on thousands of people who live near the United Center.
Good girl.
Juwan Jackson owns Every Single Day Dog Training and lives near the United Center.
Klein.
His talented furry friend wasn't the only spectacle around here recently.
I came out with my dogs one day and I saw police, FBI, and two other governmental organizations.
All right, what's wrong?
He didn't ask, but they were probably canvassing the neighborhood with flyers about the Democratic National Convention. Information was also passed out in the South Loop near McCormick Place last week. Residents and business owners in an approximately two-block radius to the north, south, east, and west from McCormick.
Any idea when the Deep Program is going to upload your episode on YouTube? I think it's Friday. I'd have to check their Patreon.
And from the United Center, we'll need to abide by special rules for a 9-day stretch beginning August 17th. Chicago police received the okay from City Council on Wednesday to enact these DNC security boundaries and to establish a ban on certain items and activities within the so-called buffer zone. Guns in large bags will be some of the things prohibited. Also on the no-go list, bikes and scooters, tents and balloons. Much to Jackson's surprise, animals will not be permitted in the secure area. Police have said that's for the dog and dog owner's safety.
It doesn't bother me too much because I have a yard, so I'm a little bit more flexible with
then
that.
Then things sunk in for the dog trainer.
So do you think they're not going to let me use this field right here? This is going, okay, all right, then it could be a slight inconvenience then, if that's the case, for sure.
Manny Cope and the barbershop he co-owns are on the cusp of the buffer zone on Ashland.
I think it's going to be busy, but probably going to be pretty hectic too. Going to getting in, getting out, getting to lunch.
The extra rules will affect him and his customers, but overall, he doesn't think it'll cut into business.
Probably going to be the safest people in Chicago that week, you know, so no, I'm cool.
You will absolutely not. Oh, he doesn't know. He doesn't know.
I
Unless things get really hairy, the barbershop won't be closing down. Other businesses like this child care center tell me they're still waiting for more information before deciding if it'll stay open. Reporting on the Windy near
buffer zone. A buffer zone is basically a way of trying to suppress the First Amendment without suppressing the First Amendment. Buffer zones have been declared unconstitutional many times when it comes to protesting things like abortion clinics. But I wonder if they're going to suppress political speech. What do you think, chat?
Your West Side, I'm Lauren Victory, CBS 2 News.
The Secret Service did not directly comment on the buffer zone ordinance, telling CBS 2 its security plans and prohibited items list are still being worked on.
Oh, is that right?
As Israel prepares to invade Rafah, violate Joe Biden's red line, and kill who knows how many more thousands of innocent men, women, and children in Gaza, we need to talk about the elephant in the room. We need to talk about the hostages. Because the Israelis say this is all about the hostages. They say we don't talk about the hostages enough. So let's do that. Let's talk today about the hostages, because there are three very important things they don't tell you about the hostages. First, for everyone who believes that Benjamin Netanyahu and his government of far-right fascists and racists are fighting their war in Gaza in order to rescue the hostages, how do they explain the fact that Netanyahu had a chance to bring all of the civilian hostages home right at the very beginning? Those aren't my words. That's not my opinion. It's the view of Chaim Rubinstein, who until very recently was a spokesman for the families of the Israeli hostages, and who said last week, quote, "We learned that Hamas offered on October 9th or 10th to release all the captive civilians in its hands if the IDF did not enter the Gaza Strip, but the government rejected the offer." In fact, the Washington Post reported on a similar proposal at the end of October, saying...
Is it true that Hassan destroyed Pierce? Oh, is there a Pierce-Morgan-Hassan debate? Damn it, I could have baited with that.
Hamas was proposing to release all foreign civilian hostages in exchange for a five-day ceasefire. Israeli civilian hostages would be released if additional demands were met, he said, including the release of Palestinian women and children in Israeli prisons and the opening of the Rafah border crossing. Second, for everyone who pops up on my Twitter feed to still tell me, well, Hamas could end this war if they just released all the hostages, have they paid any attention to anything the Israeli government has actually said on this subject? Israeli officials have said time and again that the war won't end until Hamas is destroyed, regardless of whether the hostages are released. Bezalel Smotrich, Israel's finance minister, made clear this week he was opposed to any hostage release deal that stopped Israel from going into Rafah. Now, you might say, that's just Smotrich, he's not in charge. Well, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu...
This is a clip that I wanted to replay from the speech. Joe Biden basically calling us all anti-Semites.
Experience. We know scapegoating and demonizing any minority is a threat to every minority and the very foundation of our democracy. So in moments like this, we have to put these principles that we're talking about into action. I understand people have strong beliefs and deep convictions about the world. In America, we respect and protect the fundamental right to free speech, to debate and disagree, to protest peacefully and make our voices heard. I understand that's America, but there is no place on any campus in America, any place in America, for anti-Semitism or hate speech or threats of violence of any kind.
What is he talking about? What the fuck is he talking about?
Whether against Jews or anyone else, violent attacks, destroying property, is not peaceful protest. It's against the law. And we are not a lawless country. We're a civil society. We uphold the rule of law.
So in other words, these people were attacked because of rules that were changed by the universities after these protests were set up. Based on the content of the protesters' speech, basically they didn't support the Israeli attack on Gaza, and they wanted the U.S. to not support it, and they wanted their university to divest their investments. away from the war. That was what the protesters are for. Violence? What violence? There's no violence. The only violence I've seen is from the UCLA counter protesters, from the cops.
And no one should have to hide or be brave just to be themselves.
Stateside apartheid, don't give me the 2-1.
To the Jewish community, I want you to know, I see your fear, your hurt, and your pain. Let me reassure you, as your president, you're not alone. You belong. You always have and you always will. And my commitment to the safety of the Jewish people, the security of Israel, and its right to exist as an independent Jewish state is ironclad, even when we disagree.
And it's not going to stop, chat. Joe Biden wants to fuck with us? Let's fuck with you. We're going to fuck with you, bitch. 14 university encampments are growing in Britain. Guess what, motherfucker? It's not going away. It's going international.